Before I introduce Living Histories, I wanted to just say a few words about Amy Dillwyn's diaries and the other papers that we now hold here at Swansea University, and without which the story of Amy Dillwyn or could not be told, or certainly not this version of it. When I started to research Amy Dillwyn's fiction, I knew that she was a feminist, and I knew that she was the author of a novel called The Rebecca Rioter, and that was about it. And so I began with David Painting's biography, and I soon had his permission to look at her diaries, which he had in his possession, but under the strict proviso that I couldn't publish or even describe anything in the diaries without his express permission. So firstly, I knew there was something in there, but I was really worried, what happens if I read something vital in there that I was never allowed to share? And I had been reading Amy Dillwyn's novel, Jill, which is a fairly obviously a lesbian story. So I had my suspicions about what was in the diaries. Cut a long story short, Dillwyn's diaries are some of the most significant explorations of same-sex desire in the 19th century and genderqueer identity in life writing that we have from the 19th century. They're not racy like Anne Lister's, but they provide a slow and steady self-reflection on her feelings for another woman and the tensions between those desires and the duty of an upper-class Victorian lady. I'm not going to talk about Amy's life now because it would be impertinent when you're about to meet her. But I wanted to acknowledge the centrality of this archive to my own research and to the play that follows. Although David Painting, in his biography from the 1980s, did suppress this central theme in central thread of Amy Dillwyn's life, it didn't take that many coffees and chats with him to convince him that Amy's queer life was something to be celebrated. It was one of the most interesting things about her. And for many years, I've had nothing but his warm support in my research and in my publications. I've been allowed to publish whatever I wanted. And more importantly, he agreed to make the diaries open to the public by depositing these precious papers in Swansea University archives. For those of who can't visit the archives, and actually, let's face it, none of us can visit the archives at the moment, but the diaries have been transcribed and they will be published in book form and then in their complete form online. And in the meantime, by opening up that archive, we have been able to allow dramatists and artists and students and documentary makers to make full use of the material to inform their own studies and to generate their own interpretations of this extraordinary woman. When I first told some close colleagues about what I found in the diaries and what they revealed about Dillwyn's life and also what they confirmed about her writing, I was told to, quote, keep my powder dry, meaning not to out Amy Dillwyn until the book was ready. It was probably very good advice, but I'm actually very glad that I didn't follow it. The book isn't quite ready, but over the last 8 years, I've had the pleasure of talking to a wide range of audiences and working with documentary makers and artists and theatre makers who have brought Dillwyn's queer story to a much wider audience than my book will ever reach. And as a result, I have also seen Amy Dillwyn and her literature with fresh eyes. And I think, well, we've all been enriched as a result. So without further ado, please put your hands together virtually and welcome Living Histories Cymru with A Moral Amazon, the story of Miss Amy Dillwyn. And now you have to bear with me because I'm also crew and technician on this and I have to perform a couple of tasks and then we really will start.
Thank you. seated one day at the organ. I was weary and ill at ease, and my fingers wandered idly over the noisy keys. I know not what I was playing or what I was dreaming then, but I struck one chord of music like the sound of a great amen, like the sound of a great amen.
A Moral Amazon, the story of Miss Amy Dillwyn. In spring 1845, the eighth year of Queen Victoria's reign, a tomboy was born. Mama and Papa named her Amy, and she grew up in the family home of Hendra Voylan in Swansea, where I believe, looking closely, I think some of you may live. Now, seeing you all here, it seems to me that some of you may have been tomboys, and I wonder what you got up to when your mama was busy ordering the servants around.
I used to sneak out at night, moth hunting, mudlarking. I would pull off my dress and jump in the mud, searching for frogs. I thought if I removed my clothes, I would not get into trouble with mama. But she was not amused. She hated me showing my legs.
Our story really begins when Amy was 15. She and her family often visited the Talbots of Margam Castle. Sadly, not a real Welsh castle, but a pretendy one, financed with the shedloads of money that William Mansell Talbot was making out of his steelworks in Port Talbot.
It's fantastic. So gothic. Turrets, towers and battlements all mixed up with gay abandon. Oh, hello, Mrs. Talbot. Pleased to meet you. And hello, Olive. Yes, I'm sure we will be great friends. I am very intrigued by Olive, an invalid and just 3 years older than me.
They write long letters to each other and exchange tokens of friendship.
This is so beautiful. And here is my token for you. You like it? Yes. Of course I will stay overnight. Yes, please do come to my room when the others are asleep. I'm so excited. Here we are in our dressing gowns, talking about all manner of things until the early hours. Can I share a secret with you? I feel as if I'm going crazy for love of her. Such turmoil.
As you might imagine, it was expected that a young lady from a respectable family with a member of parliament for a father should find something useful to do in life and not be mooning around over other young ladies, but
I can't understand why Olive will not love me back as I love her. I feel angry with myself, so vexatious to the spirit. I just cannot become sensible about her. I'm always the same, foolishly in love.
After 2 years of this turmoil, Amy was presented at court and felt the pull of London life and its excitements. She would spend the season in London and concert going and visiting churches with Olive, or walking with her father in Regent's Park, where they found great amusement in people watching, studying the fashions there. Amy met other women like herself and wondered.
I wonder if they are just good friends. Now I see them together, it seems obvious Miss Barnett has fallen in love with Mrs. Glynn. How can a woman fall for another woman and stay true to that love? Our affections are so strong. Oh, Olive. No more self-indulgent wanderings. Duty calls. London is full of so many idle society people busily doing nothing. I wonder if I will ever be of any use in the world.
Amy, desperate to do something useful, reluctantly bids farewell to the pleasures of London life and returns to Swansea, to the family life at Hendrevoilan.
Time for what I call poor peopling. Visiting the sick and helping the poor with Mama. Excuse me. Running stalls and raffles for charity and wheedling people to part with their money for rubbish they do not want. Mama loves tea and twaddle and the leaving of visiting cards. And like all politicians, my dear Papa does the rounds, buttering up Swansea shopkeepers for a vote. What a bore it is being a woman. Such an unadventurous and quiet state which will never suit such hot blood as mine. Any kind of stagnation is misery. I shall go mad. My chief intellectual exertion today is remembering which hoops we have been through at croquet.
Now, Amy knew from her poor peopling that there is much work to do. She still had no sense of purpose in life. Perhaps she should join the Holy Sisters of Mercy and really be of service. Then marriage loomed.
On Sunday, my cousin, Llewellyn Thomas, proposed to me while the family were away. At least he proposed in person, unlike the vicar, who did it by letter. Mama will be delighted I will be off her hands, and he is kind to me. Yes. For their sakes, I will say yes.
Marriage plans were fixed. Amy was photographed in her engagement dress, chosen, of course, by her mama. Everything began spiralling...
Spiralling out of control! I fear I will never be Amy Dillwyn again. Llewellyn calls me cold and impassible. But how can he know my doubts and struggles? I feel like a furnace in flames of uncertainty. Perhaps I will go mad.
Fate intervened. Amy received news that Llewellyn had died of smallpox in Paris only 4 months after their engagement.
How do I feel? I accepted a man with whom I was not really in love. I shall send snowdrops to the funeral. I'm quite changed. And what of my future now? Why should women always marry? If I am to be an old maid, well, so be it. Yo soy quien soy. I am who I am.
And then Amy's mama, Bessie, died. Duty called. Unmarried daughters stayed at home, kept Papa company, and managed the household. Amy proved herself a competent manager, even of the home farm.
So many petty concerns in managing a great household. Quite wearisome. I feel very alone and put to the wall, even here in church. I could see Olive, dear, sweet Olive. I wonder if we have a spiritual affinity. Does she pray for me? I'm still so infatuated with her. What a fool I am.
A popular poem of the time, The Lost Chord, spoke directly to Amy. Inspired, she set it to music. Unfortunately, a Mr. Arthur Sullivan beat her to it.
Music expresses something that words or thought cannot define, yet which is part of oneself, deep and unutterable. When Olive and I take the waters in Buxton, I will find courage and share it with her. I have sought, but I seek it vainly, that one lost chord divine that comes from the heart of the organ and enters into mine. Oh, Olive, do you feel its beauty as I do? Olive was kind and distant as ever. "Well done, my dear," she said to me. "Very nice. Now, we are taking the waters at 5, are we not?" And that was all.
Amy laughs at herself as she writes in her journal.
"It's so idiotic to expect more. Olive is not bound to me in any sense, though she does not know it. She is my wife, for surely after wooing her for 15 years, she must be my wife by now. I should like to have been a knight in the old days of chivalry, and whether she cared for me or not, I would never have deserted my lady love while I lived."
Time passed. Imagine the great house, Hendry of Oilen, the shutters drawn. Amy Dillwyn lay on her chaise long, in a grey half-light where nothing mattered. An invalid with a mysterious illness. She read and dreamed and dreamed and read, day after day, year after year.
"My wisdom is quite gone to the winds. I wonder if I'm half a man and the male half of myself fell in love with her years ago and can't fall out of it again. Hoping. I think of one thing which no one else knows. Such an artificial life. I can do it no longer. I want to go out, but I'm stuck to the sofa like a limpet on a rock, clinging on for life. I visit no one, and no one visits me. I can hear voices. Is it a dream? No. Only father reminiscing."
"Nearly 40 years since those damned Rebecca riots. So many men sentenced to transportation by us magistrates. Was it the right thing to do? Tollgate charges were damned expensive back then. Tuppence a pig. I don't blame them for disguising themselves as women and rioting.
Oh, father, always rambling on. Wait, though. Men dressed as women. I will write up the rioter's story. I must be able to write a little. After all, the Spectator pays me 5 guineas for one of my reviews. True, I have no genius for literature, but it would use my brain, even though my muscles are useless. I will write one chapter of a novel and then see."
And it came to pass that in 1880, the 43rd year of Queen Victoria's reign...
"My first novel, The Rebecca Rioter by E.A. Dillwyn. I used my initials so people might think I was a man and read it. I found the Rebecca so fascinating. We stopped to blacken our faces and put on our women's dresses in the soft July twilight. We certainly were a queer-looking lot of women, with beards and whiskers peeping out under the white caps."
The Rebecca Rioter was a runaway success and translated into Russian by the Soviets. E.A. Dillwyn was to publish 7 novels in 10 years.
"What do the reviewers say? E.A. Dillwyn's novels are daring, experimental, quietly cynical, especially about the upper classes. This one has fathomed my sex. There is a good deal of humour in Miss Dillwyn. Even a touch of Miss Austen. Wonderful!"
But it would be 150 years before academics, such as Professor Kirsty Bohatter, began to write articles with intriguing titles about our Amy. "A queer-looking lot of women, cross-dressing, transgender ventriloquism and same-sex desire in the fiction of Miss Amy Dillwyn. Mistress and maid, homoeroticism, cross-class desire and disguise in 19th century fiction." Could Amy's novel Jill be a code for her years of unrequited love for Olive?
"Dear readers, I leave that to you. I will only say how a great burden is lifted whenever I insert the last full stop. Jill is my favourite character, a heroine who runs away from home, disguises herself as a maid, and falls hopelessly in love with her mistress. All sorts of scrapes and adventures along the way. No sentimental endings and not a husband in sight. My heroines are new women, robust enough to fight for what they want, to face opposition and male exploitation. They are never decorative dolls. And I am no longer a limpet on the couch.
Fate again intervenes. Within the next few years, Amy's brother Harry threw his life away on drink, and her father died from a stroke whilst campaigning. The end of the family line.
And the end of the family fortune. My father may have been a great politician, but he was no businessman. He owned the Llansamlet Spelter Works and died with a deficit of £100,000. The family is horribly disgraced. I watch my home of 40 years being put up for sale and all our beautiful belongings auctioned off one by one. How I long for Olive by my side. Such foolish longings. She is still on my brain. Do I have some kind of heart or brain disease? Duty calls. I'm going to uphold the family name and put the Spelter Works back on track. The jobs of over 300 men will be saved, and the income from increased productivity will be paid back to our creditors.
On Amy's first visit to the Spelter Works, she was quite overwhelmed.
Oh, will I ever get used to all the noise and dust and fumes? No wonder they say Swansea is the home of the devil.
It came to pass in days of yore, the devil chanced upon Landor. Quoth he, by all this fume and stink, I can't be far from home, I think.
My manager, Mr. Caulfield, is an excellent man. We plan to reinvest all profits. I've taken lodgings. This morning I travelled by train to work, and I will cover the 4 miles home on foot. Now I can walk again. There are 3 books on metallurgy waiting on my desk. I went to bed as usual last night, and when I arose, I had become a man of business.
Woman and cigar, literary business woman who delights in the weed, crowed the Morning Leader headline. Indeed, Amy's fortunes were closely followed by the press, obsessed with Miss Dillwyn's cigars rather than her industrial successes and intrepid trips to the zinc mines in Algeria.
Cigars. A wonderfully soothing occupation. Wondering how I learnt to smoke. When my brother and I were small, we sneaked out early one morning to go fishing. We found a cigar in the hall and smoked it. Harry was sick, but I wasn't. Once I was in a railway compartment with a fidgety gentleman who sat opposite me.
Excuse me, madam, would you mind awfully if I smoked?
Of course not, sir. Will you try one of mine? He left the carriage at the next station.
Back in Swansea, rumblings and dissent abounded. Not everyone was keen on a new woman businessman blowing clouds of smoke and speaking her mind at meetings. Opinions were divided.
Women of business are unnatural. They're far too emotional.
Miss Dillwyn deals fairly with everyone. She has proven business ability.
That Dillwyn woman is very mannish. Men's hats and boots.
Miss Dillwyn is pioneering and original in deeds and dress.
Disgusting. Women and cigars.
Miss Dillwyn stands for sex equality.
I do indeed stand for sex equality. I've won a place on the hospital board, but not the harbour board, a very male preserve. The Cambrian Daily Leader sums it up. Sex disability is very real.
Miss Dillwyn certainly gained a reputation, and as if that wasn't enough, new women and men like herself were caricatured in music hall song. Masculine women, feminine men, which is the rooster, which is the hen? It's all to tell them apart today and say, sister is busy learning to shave, brother just loves his permanent wave. It's all to tell them apart today, hey, hey. Girls were girls and boys were boys when I was a tot. Now it's hard to tell who's who and even what. Knickers and trousers, baggy and wide. Nobody knows who's walking inside. Those masculine women and feminine men, I'll say.
That nonsense doesn't deter me. Dress reform for me. Homburg hat, yellow rose, purple skirt, at funerals and all. I heard Mrs. Pankhurst speak last week. Liberating. Women's emancipation suits me very well. Votes for women.
But sad to say, life for this moral Amazon, being dutiful and true to herself, came at a cost.
On my 49th birthday, not a living soul remembered it. I have always felt that we should all be independent, but now I have no sympathetic bond with anyone. I know the bitterness of a half-broken heart and the desire for life's pleasures. We moral Amazons sometimes long to lay aside our strength and be loved and cared for. Still, I am who I am.
After 10 years, Amy had turned the family firm around and sold it very profitably to a German company.
At last, the money to buy my own home, Teaglin. How wonderful to sleep in my own bed, first time in a decade. Choosing my furniture, I feel just like a child playing doll's house. And how my dog, Crack, loves the garden. I go shopping at Ben Evans Emporium in Swansea. I'll have that table, those chairs and this china. What's that noise?
A mass demonstration is taking place. You are all seamstresses on strike. Get ready to make yourselves heard. Chant after me. Down with
sweatshop.
Silence. Miss Dillwyn will speak.
You Ben Evans girls are so courageous to go on strike and without a union, and very good chanting, if I may say so. Well, you have public sympathy. I will tell my friends and family to remove their custom from this store. You want me to speak at the rally? Yes. Of course I will, especially now that I am president of the Swansea branch of the National Union of Women's Suffrage Societies. Seamstresses are starving. They are slaves to the needle. 12 hours and no break. Employers have no right to grind poor people down so. Wages should be enough to put something aside for a rainy day. Call for a parliamentary inquiry.
The Ben Evans girls hit the national press. The case was reported in Parliament as a breach of the Factory Act, and in 1911 the store was ordered to pay compensation and reduce working hours, though not by enough. Time passed.
I am older now. Mellow. My moral Amazon is not so forceful. I'm allowing myself to enjoy life. Opening bazaars, reviewing the local... Oh my goodness, one too many drinks, I think. Reviewing the local militia and such like. Here I am, wintering on the Riviera, playing bridge and baccarat in Monte Carlo. I still smoke my cigars, which keeps me in a cheerful humour. And I still wear tailor-made clothes, mannish felt hats, and care not for the gaze of tourists. And I have never forgotten my love for Olive, how my spirit sought hers. In the end, it seems, I am who I am.
The end.